students behind me learning what it's like to perform robotic surgery. MCN2's Renee O'Neill with why surgeons say this is the way of the future.
Based off location alone, it's clear there's a strong connection between this section of Highway 9 and the Sheriff's Office here in Lancaster. I'm CN2's Zane Cena, and county lawmakers are making that connection even stronger by dedicating a portion of this roadway to a former sheriff.
Hey, what's up, everyone? Jeremy Wyden here at Terry Field, home of the Winthrop softball team, who's under new leadership this year. But it's a face that's very familiar to people in the Rock Hill area. I'll have a sit-down with Coach Kendall Fuller later in sports.
Good evening, and thanks for making CN2 News a part of your night. I'm Laura Bree Monday, always glad to have you. Our top story tonight, 600 surgeries and counting. MUSC Health Lancaster Medical Center says that's how many surgeries have been completed with its robotic machine named the Da Vinci Surgical System. They say the machine offers residents within the community access to better health care in their hometown. On this Tuesday, the hospital showing off the cutting-edge surgical care to community members and York Technical College students who are studying in the medical field. During the event, students could practice on the robot as if they were in an operating room. Officials with the Da Vinci say even though it's a robot, the surgeon is always in complete control, making patient outcomes, they say, and recovery times much smoother. The Da Vinci has performed surgeries in urology, gynecology, cardiac, and more, as well as just general surgery.
Pretty much we're helping patients. We can minimize pain. It's innovative, and it's really going to keep changing into the future, and I hope to see where it takes me.
Great for the patient, for the safety. The patient are so comfortable after robotic surgery because they have like the smallest incision that you can do with the surgery. And we have lower risk to switch to open.
MUSC Lancaster Medical Center got the Da Vinci Surgical System back in February of 2022. On Wednesday, Lancaster School District STEM and STEAM students, as well as the Chester County District, will be on site to participate in different activities all about the Da Vinci. A Chester County man who has been on the run for a week on a murder charge is now behind bars. The Chester County Sheriff's Office says Zycarion White was taken into custody Monday evening. Deputies say White is charged in the shooting death of 26-year-old Jamarie McCrory. The crime happened on Tuesday, September the 12th, at a location off of Old Winsboro Road in the Great Falls area. Authorities say White was out on bond for another incident in Lancaster County at the time of the murder. He has been charged with murder and is currently being held at the Chester County Detention Center. A York County teenager is at the Department of Juvenile Justice after he pretended to be a York County Sheriff's deputy, according to officials. They say the 17-year-old man was stopped by deputies early Sunday morning as he was in the act of stopping a car near the South Carolina state line. The report says at least four different people reported being stopped by a black Dodge Charger with red and blue strobe lights. Officials say the teenager was even wearing police-style ballistic vest and a duty belt with handcuffs and a holster, along with an airsoft plastic pistol with the orange safety tip painted black. Sheriff Kevin Tolston says traffic stops can be one of the most unpredictable and dangerous aspects of a police officer's duties. He says they're thankful no one was hurt, especially the young man. When asked why he was stopping the cars, the teen responded, quote, for the fun of it. Crime Stoppers of York County holding its first ever special law enforcement training for agencies across York County. During this training session, those in attendance got to hear from a woman named Megan France. She's a training specialist for law enforcement out of the University of Tennessee. She speaks about emotional intelligence when interacting with the public and other law enforcement personnel. Crime Stoppers of York County says that they wanted to bring this training to law enforcement as a way to better their skills when out in the field, but also provide them with more resources for free.
A sense of communication. How do you communicate? How do you get information and turn it into intelligence and then use that for going out solving a crime? Because the better trained we are, the better we can be at our job.
All proceeds from this event do go back to Crime Stoppers of York County's tip pool for those who give tips that lead to arrests. If you have a tip when it comes to a crime in York County, you can reach out to them. Just visit crimestoppersyorkcounty.com. The stretch of Highway 9 in front of the Lancaster County Sheriff's Office is getting a name change to honor a former sheriff. The road will now be known as Sheriff Williford Lee Fail Memorial Highway, after the father of current Sheriff Barry Fail, in recognition of his service to the county for more than 28 years. It's all being made possible by county representatives from both the Senate and State House, who worked together to get the roadway's name officially changed. Each of those elected officials visited the sheriff's office on this Tuesday to unveil the new road sign and to meet with Fail's family members.
We're very humbled. It means a lot, and he would be just so surprised and humbled by this action. And we thank the delegation for what they have done. I'm sure the first time we go by, it'll be very emotional.
Fail's family says this just adds to the legacy of the sheriff, who did pass away in 2022 from natural causes, hoping the sign will help drivers remember his life and his work. York County Council passing two major economic investment deals overnight. First, Project Cobra was unanimously approved, according to our news partners with WRHI. It has since been revealed as the QTS Data Center. It's projecting $1 billion in investment with 12 new jobs. QTS owns property for the site in the Campbell Road and Hands Mill Highway area of Lake Wylie. The other big vote, Silfab Solar, passed by a vote of 4-3. This deal will bring $150 million of investment and potentially 800 new jobs. Before passing, a few amendments were made, which included making the minimum pay $22 per hour, insurance, and some details on the fee in lieu of taxes agreement. Many residents in Fort Mill were vocal about not supporting this investment, citing traffic and overcrowding around the area of the business on Logistics Lane. Here's our latest picture of the day. Congratulations to Sydney Belt. She's a Fort Mill High School student who was invited to speak at an upcoming panel on student involvement in computer science at the 2023 South Carolina Computer Science and STEM Summit. The summit will explore the roles of computer science and how it can shape our state's future. Well done. Want to see your photo's picture of the day? Just email it to news@cn2.com. Welcome back to CN2 News. Planning underway for the fifth cycle of the Pennies for Progress program in York County. Here's your chance to voice your opinion on what roads you think need to be widened, paved, or improved. York County Council appoints a commission of citizens who pore over all the requests from the public and create a project priority list based on that input. There are many public meetings between now and September in cities and communities throughout York County. The last meeting for the public to weigh in is tomorrow. That's Wednesday, September 20th, here in Rock Hill at the Rock Hill Operations Center. It's going to start at 6 p.m. If you can't make the meeting, you can still give your opinion on the Pennies for Progress website. Once the final project list for Pennies 5 is approved, residents will vote on it during the general election of November 2024. In tonight's CN2 Digital Dashboard, Winthrop University moved to fifth place, its highest ranking ever among public universities in the South, according to U.S. News & World Report's 2024 edition of Best Colleges. Winthrop stood out in categories like Best Colleges for Veterans, Best Value, and Best Undergraduate Business Programs. American Legion Post 34 is hosting its 17th annual memorial fundraiser this weekend to raise money for York County veterans. This year, organizers say they are trying something different and have an event for families at the American Legion Post in Rock Hill. It's again Saturday, 11 to 4. That's September 23rd. The address is 524 Heckle Boulevard. The City of Rock Hill sharing the parking at University Center is now free for the first 2 hours. It had been 90 minutes. You should still register your vehicle upon arriving with premium parking to receive parking reminders. There's a QR code. It's very easy. Still to come here on CN2 News, a conversation with a woman who is raising awareness about head trauma and her personal connection. Stay with us.
If you are a foodie from Chester, then you've probably eaten the delicious food at Hillside Restaurant and Bar. But before it was serving up unique dishes, it was a McCrory's Five and Dime store. The property had been three different buildings that made up the store. In the mid-1930s, the three individual buildings were torn down, and the current Art Deco-style building was completed in 1937, where the McCrory store opened back up. Selling everything from shoes, clothing and housewares to candy and toys, McCrory's existed in Chester until the early 1970s. Fast forward to late 2021, Russ and Gina White began working on the building. They kept the original maple floors, tin ceilings, and even uncovered original McCrory's window signs under a layer of paint. In December of 2022, the couple opened a unique brick oven pizza restaurant, cafe, and bar called Hillside Restaurant and Bar. So if you get hungry for some great food and history, take a step back in time at Hillside Restaurant and Bar. CN2's Minute in History is proudly brought to you by Rock Hill Coca-Cola Bottling Company.
Well, welcome back to CN2 News. We have a great opportunity to learn about a woman who has a fantastic story, who is raising awareness about a 5K race that's coming up. It's called Headed for Hope 5K. It's for brain tumor research and education. So let's welcome Amanda Gent to CN2 News. And Amanda, you've got an amazing story that starts back in November of 2022. Actually, it goes back further, but we'll let you tell that story in a minute. But take us back to November of 2022 in Charlotte, if you can.
Yeah, sure. So that was the Charlotte Marathon day. And unfortunately, I was injured at the time, so I wasn't able to run and compete. I decided to cheer the marathon runners along on my Elliptico and was riding around all of Charlotte and was headed back to my car on Trade Street in Uptown when the front wheel of my tire was kind of knocked a little from one trolley track and then fell into the second trolley track, which stopped me and ejected me from the bike. I landed face first, suffered some facial fractures and had some slip disc in my back and a severe concussion, later considered traumatic brain injury. And just a really scary time from that, not being able to run anymore and having to recover from that, and was progressing quite well until February, where I started showing signs of stroke. And so I was sent to the emergency room and later admitted to the hospital, and under the care of the doctor, some of the doctors, was diagnosed with a Chiari malformation. Which is a progressive genetic illness where the back of the brain, the cerebellum, actually kind of sits tucked into the spinal canal. And if the descent is so far, it can cause some symptoms, headaches, imbalance, that kind of thing, and might even require surgery. And so I've been under the care of Dr. Jowdy at Carolina Neurosurgery and Spine. And he has been following that, and it turns out I will have a neurosurgeon for life as we kind of walk this journey together.
It's always important to have a doctor in your life, and you've got a neurosurgeon, so that's fantastic. And I understand your relationship with this practice dates back even longer.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking like 15, 16 years. Right after I got married, my mother was diagnosed with a glioblastoma, grade 4 brain tumor. In her frontal lobe, and under the care of the same practice, she had surgery and was a participant in two clinical trials under the watch of Dr. Asher, who was a physician at the practice, and lots of strides were made with that, and she was able to help FDA approval of one medication to treat brain tumors. And unfortunately, she did pass in 2009, but it was always a dream to have a foundation. One step closer was my dream that maybe someday somebody would pay me to run in honor and in generosity to help support brain tumors and awareness and education and even patient support. And I think that's what brings us to today. This is the fruition of that, not by my doing, you know, but now we're able to run and raise money and awareness for that.
Well, it's called Headed for Hope 5K. It takes place on Saturday, September the 23rd. All the information is on your screen right there. It's up in Charlotte. What is your hope through this race? Is it just to raise awareness? Is it to encourage people to be careful when they're running or biking? What is your end game here? What do you hope will happen?
Yeah, I think all of us are impacted in some form or fashion. And so it's good for us to have the education first and foremost. But also I want to support current patients who are struggling and walking this journey. It's a scary one when anything impacts your brain, whether it's a tumor or a Chiari malformation. It changes life pretty drastically. And so just to support those patients and families, and then you know, there isn't a cure for brain cancer or brain tumors. And so that would ultimately be the goal, that we would be able to raise enough money to continue to fund research. And that, you know, having a platform on social media, just being able to share that with people and what that means is really important to you.
Well, your before and after pictures of November of 2022 to today, it's unbelievable. And you were very adamant about wearing your helmet, much like a seatbelt. Sometimes it can be deemed uncool to wear, but you were just saying, wear your helmet, because in your case, it literally did save your life.
Absolutely. You know, the brain controls everything that we do in life, and we would be silly not to protect it. And so whether you're out just for a Sunday stroll on your cycle or you're going, you know, around the velodrome, a helmet should be a non-negotiable. It's literally what saved my life. We wouldn't be sitting in these chairs if I weren't wearing one.
Well, your story is an inspiration. You're a very active person. So it is interesting to kind of see you have to look at life a little different when someone has been on the go and so health conscious as you are, to look now at things in a different light. But it just goes to show all of us that it can be done. And a little hurdle is good sometimes in life, and you get over it and you move forward. And in your case, you're able to raise awareness and help to educate us all, for sure. Well, that's just great, Amanda. I know it's sometimes tough to talk about, but thanks for sharing your story with us.
Sure.
Well, you can do your part. All you have to do is sign up to run for that Headed for Hope 5K. All the information is right there on your screen. All right, stay with CN2 News. We'll be right back right after this.
Carolina Connection is brought to you by Wild Birds Unlimited. For more information, visit rockhill.wbu.com or indianland.wbu.com. Wild Birds Unlimited. We bring people and nature together.
Hey, what's up, everyone? And welcome into this Tuesday edition of CN2 Sports. Jeremy Wanda here, just down the road at Terry Field, home of the Winthrop softball program. And I'm joined right now by the team's new head coach, a familiar face to the area, Ms. Kendall Fuller. Kendall, how you doing?
Jeremy, I'm great. Thanks for coming out today. It's good to see you.
Good to see you, too. Thanks for having us out here. And it's great to have you back. And what has this been like for you being back now as head coach of Winthrop softball?
Well, I appreciate it. Feels like home. So it's been great to come back. Still getting in the groove of everything, but it feels great to be here.
Yes, obviously you come on a little bit late in the process, so you don't get the full traditional recruiting window that coaches are used to getting. So what kind of challenges have that presented, and how have you attacked the task?
Sure, we might be playing catch up just a little bit with this recruiting class, but we're after it. We've been running some camps and things like that, and so we're getting to see some kids. The interest level is really high for Winthrop softball right now, and I'm excited about it. So we're working through it, and we'll make it happen.
I'm sure you haven't spent so much time in this program. I'm sure you like to keep an eye on it, even though you were coaching somewhere else. This team got off to a great start last year, kind of dwindled a little bit towards the end of the season, but you had a good base to build off of. And is it just about building on that foundation of last year now?
Yeah, absolutely. There's a great set of returning players. There's a senior class of 10 that is huge, and they're motivated, they're working hard, they're ready to go. And so, there's a lot to build off of. There's a ton of speed on this team. There's great pitching on this team that's returning. So we're hitting the ground running.
Yeah, so sounds like a lot to be excited about. And for you now as head coach, of course, we know you spent a few years at Lees McRae in Banner Elk, North Carolina. Before that, spent a number of years here as the assistant. During your time at Lees McRae, how did you see yourself grow as a coach and, you know, prepare you to be a head coach now back at Winthrop?
Sure. So Lees McRae was a great experience for me. I spent 3 seasons there. We grew every year and got better and better. It was great for me to be on my own. Obviously, when I was here before, I had Coach Cook, and so he was a huge mentor. And so going out and being a head coach on your own is a little bit different, but figured out how to do things and bringing some of that here.
Yeah, obviously you mentioned Coach Cook, you know, a great man. And it was sad, you know, to hear the news of his passing over the summer. But for you, what did he mean to you, not just on a professional level as a coach, but personally as well?
Yeah, so I spent 5 seasons down here with Coach Cook. And so he was a huge influence, not just on my coaching career, but on my life personally. He had core values that I'm bringing back to Winthrop with me. And so I'm excited to be able to honor him in that way. And really to bring some traditions back to Winthrop Winthrop softball that have been missing, and looking forward to getting those rolling again.
Yeah, and when you mentioned Winthrop softball tradition, there's a lot of people that are very familiar with this program. One couple that immediately comes to mind is Ann and Vernon Terry, whose name is on the field. You know, what has your reception been like with them and other people in the area who are just happy to see you back?
Yeah, so I was super excited to reconnect with the Terrys, and they're huge influences on this program. They've been impactful people that we wouldn't be here without them today with all the facilities and things that we have, and not just that, but the time that they give us and the influence that they have on our young team is awesome. And I'm looking forward to really getting them back involved. They've already been out to practice. We've eaten some ice cream with them, and so looking forward to hitting the road with them in the spring as well.
Yeah, you know you're going to have a good time when the Terriers are around.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. We've got to get the cookouts going and get Vernon back on the grill.
Yes, and for you, you know, every coach obviously likes to put their own stamp on the program when they take over. So for you, for the fans, what is this team going to look like differently than they have in the past when they come out to see them in the spring?
Well, I think we're just in our first week of team practice right now. We're about to get started with fall ball, but this team's balanced. We've got a lot of speed on this team. We've got a great pitching staff and returning pitching. That's going to be a good base for us. I think they'll be exciting on the field. You'll see a good product that's exciting to watch.
All right. Well, we're looking forward to it, and best of luck to you.
Jeremy, thanks so much.
Thank you for your time. And again, that is the new head softball coach here at Winthrop University, Ms. Kendall Fuller. But that's going to do it for now. Hope you have a good evening, and we will see you on Wednesday at 6 o'clock with a brand new newscast. Good night, everyone.